38 all. Bills can win it here. Wright puts it down. The kick is on the way, and it is good! And the Bills have won it! The Bills have won it! The Bills have won it! They win it 41-38! Incredible! What a comeback by the Bills!
Jacksonville, perfect record on the line right here.
Welcome to another episode of Disguise Coverage. I am Anthony. I am your host here on Disguise Coverage. Whatever platform or service you are listening to this podcast on, watching this podcast on, please rate and review and subscribe to Disguise Coverage. It means the world to everything. It's tremendously helpful. While you're there checking out Disguise Coverage and rating and reviewing and subscribing, check out all the other great content that is part of the Cover One Sports Network. We've got the Cover One podcast that happens twice a week with Greg and Aaron. We've got the Hoof podcast with Sterling and Eric and another Anthony. All great content covering you pretty much every day of the week, 24 hours a day, covering everything and anything Buffalo Bills. Find me on the old Twitter at pro_ant. That's pro 2 underscores ANT. Feel free to give me a follow on the old Twitter or Bags of Gold. I'm also down for those things. For the regular watchers of this podcast on the old YouTube, you notice that I got a different setup going this week. I'm in a different room, got a nice little window behind me with some plants, a nice visual aesthetic. See the mic here a little bit in the front, trying out some new things in terms of visuals and some acoustics and things like that. And also a metaphorical representation of coming out of the bye week, starting fresh, starting anew, as the Buffalo Bills head into a very important stretch of their season, the final six games, really tightening things up and coming into and deciding who they're going to be here in this 2020 season. Where do they finish in the AFC? Where do they finish in the AFC East? How do they match up come playoff time, ideally come playoff time? Shout out to Army of One. Let's go with a whole bunch of exclamation points. Let's go. I appreciate you. That's a good comment. And a good comment here from Rico. Can't wait to see the Bills come out with all that time to prepare. I am excited to see what the Bills look like when they come out with all this time to prepare against the Chargers. And that is the focus of this episode, hence the title. I'm sure you guessed it. Know Thy Enemy, Buffalo Bills versus Los Angeles Chargers. Also, don't kill me if I say San Diego Chargers. I am mentally having to consciously think of calling them the Los Angeles Chargers. I slip up all the time. Same thing with the Raiders. I instinctively call them the Oakland Raiders still. I have to mentally be like, okay, Las Vegas. So don't kill me if I call them San Diego. But it's a good matchup for the Bills. I think it's one that the Bills have several advantages on paper when you look at the scheme and the matchup potential for both of these teams. But it's also a game that is going to test the Bills in several ways. The Chargers are not a bad team whatsoever. I know their record may not indicate that. They are 3-7. I also think, just to build on that quickly, the Chargers seem to be in this weird loop almost every single year where they're like a good team or they've got good pieces, but they don't win and they shoot themselves in the foot and they lose these heartbreaking close games. It was arguably one of the stories of Philip Rivers' career when he was with the Chargers, and now he's moved on to Indianapolis, and it's almost the same thing, kind of rearing its ugly head, unfortunately, for the Chargers. But they're not a bad team. They are 3-7. Their wins came against the Cincinnati Bengals, Jacksonville Jaguars, and the New York Jets. Obviously, three teams that are not powerhouses in the NFL by any means. They are 15th in the NFL in points per game with 26 points per game. They're third in the NFL in passing yards per game with 279.6 passing yards per game. Shout out to Justin Herbert of the Los Angeles Chargers, who we're going to get into in this episode. They're 11th in rushing yards per game with 121.3. And a lot of that is without their standout running back, Austin Eckler, who's good in real football and I'm sure many people would also tell you he's very good in fantasy football. The Charger defense, which has been banged up for a decent amount of this year, they're 24th in the NFL in points per game, averaging 27.3 points given up per game. They are 12th in the NFL in passing yards per game allowed with 228.7. They are 15th in rushing yards per game allowed with 115.3. Continuing to know thy enemy, the Los Angeles Chargers, this week. Also, I'm starting to see a lot of questions and thoughts and everything rolling through the comments. I'm going to get to those. I love all the engagement. I love all the interaction. So don't think if you've thrown something up there, I haven't gotten to it in the first couple minutes of it being up there, that I won't get to it. That's false. I will get to it. I appreciate that. And I love the comments. The Chargers are a team, even when in their wins and their losses, again, they come into this game against the Bills 3-7. Almost every game that the Chargers have been in this year has been a close game. In week two, they lost to the Chiefs by 3 in overtime. That was Justin Herbert's first NFL taste, his first game action, and it all came, for those of you who don't know, because Tyrod Taylor, incumbent starter for the Chargers coming into this year, was basically had murder attempted on him by his doctor for the Chargers, and his lung got stabbed, and he had to miss some time. Herbert stepped up, played very well against the Chiefs, and the Chargers lost to the Chiefs by 3 in overtime. They lost by 7 to the Buccaneers after being up 24-7 in that game. They lost by 3 to the New Orleans Saints in overtime after being up 20-3 in that game. They lost to Denver by 1. They lost to Vegas by 5. But even in their wins, it's been close. They beat the Bengals by only 3. That was, again, a week 1 game led by Tyrod Taylor. They beat the Jaguars by 10. And they beat the Jets last week by 6. A game that the Chargers were up comfortably for a majority of that game against the Jets, but in the second half, they weren't as sharp as they were in the first. They gave up some deep plays, especially to Breshad Perriman. Joe Flacco started to get things moving in the second half, and they got beat a little bit. This Chargers team, which is kind of a microcosm of previous Chargers teams, they've got talent, they've got quality, they are in every game that they play. They're not bad enough to get blown out or get destroyed, but they're also just not good enough to get over the hump and win close games and beat good teams. But they do have talent. They do have some ability. And it's going to be an interesting matchup for the Bills because of the talent that the Chargers have in certain areas, especially on offense. I think this is a game for the Bills where we want to continue to see the trending of the defense. I've already seen some comments come through asking questions about the defense and some offense too. How do we compensate for certain losses? But the Bills defense has been a large storyline for a majority of the year. Coming into the year, as we've stated multiple times on this show, I don't think anyone thought the Bills defense would be a liability or have many vulnerabilities when it came to game in and game out action, week in and week out. And as we sit here coming out of the bye week, the defense has been a unit that we've had to have some concern about. I wasn't as much on the cliff's edge as other people were. I thought they would course correct. I thought they would get better. But they're middle of the road at best in a lot of areas. And that's something we didn't expect. We've seen this unit be top 5 and top 3 in several metrics and statistics over the past couple of years. All credit to Josh Allen and the offense for what they did last year in getting the Bills to the playoffs. But I think if you had to give more credit to a unit of who did what last year in 2019 for the Buffalo Bills, most would say that we hung our hat on the defense and the defense was responsible for the success the Bills had last year in 2019. It kept us in a lot of games. And it's a unit this year that, to be honest, which I always am, has disappointed in several ways. But the defense has gotten better over the past several weeks. I know the point totals given up to Seattle and the point totals given up to Arizona and that stupid play at the end of the game that we're not really going to speak about. That play is kind of a play that must not be named or spoke about. For all intents and purposes, we are in, you know, Hogwarts in a Harry Potter world, and that stupid play to DeAndre Hopkins is like Voldemort. So we're not going to speak its name. We're not going to talk about it. We know it exists, but we're just going to kind of meh. Let's not really talk about it. Let's not really engage in it. But those two games, the Cardinals and the Seahawks, those were two strong offensive football teams led by two MVP candidates, especially at the time of that Bills game and the Seahawks game against the Bills. Russell Wilson came into that game as an MVP favorite, not a dark horse, the MVP favorite. And the Bills made him turn the ball over 4 times. And they really only gave up 20 points. I know the total that they gave up 34, but again, one of those was garbage time, and another one was a blown coverage 50-yard touchdown pass. They looked better against Seattle, and they got better and looked decent against Arizona. They kept the Bills in the game when the offense was sputtering in the second half. They had several key three and outs that they forced. They pretty much hemmed up and contained Kyler Murray for a decent part of the game. But Bills lost against Arizona. And now we come out of the bye, and we face another young, explosive quarterback leading a talented, explosive offense. And that's where we're going to start with the analysis of knowing thy enemy in the Los Angeles Chargers this week for the Buffalo Bills coming out of the bye. Knowing this team and knowing this matchup for the Buffalo Bills this week, it starts and ends with Justin Herbert. He was the sixth overall pick in the 2020 NFL draft, aka the draft that was most recently passed, that happened in the spring of this year, out of the University of Oregon. He was a good prospect coming out, but I don't think anybody thought he was going to have the year that he's had so far. He is currently on pace, and these are tremendous things that I'm about to go into with Justin Herbert. And I often I downgrade some of the accomplishments of offenses today in the NFL because I think it is easier to be successful offensively in the NFL in today's day and age. It's easier to play quarterback to a degree. The offensive schemes are so sophisticated, so educated. And then when you add things that have been implemented in the game overall and affected the defensive side of the ball, you can't hit the quarterback in certain areas. You can't hit a ball carrier or receiver in certain areas. You can't touch this player at this time or at this distance or here or there. You can't look at a guy the wrong way or it's a flag. The game is skewed towards the offensive side. The game and the rules and the structure favors the offensive side of the football. Regardless of that, Justin Herbert is having a fantastic rookie season. He is currently on pace for 397 completions, 4,498 passing yards, and 37 passing touchdowns. All of those would be rookie quarterback records, which is fantastic. The rookie touchdown record right now is held by Baker Mayfield. Boo. He has 27. That's the rookie touchdown record. Baker Mayfield set that in his rookie year. Again, 27. Justin Herbert already has 22, which is also one more passing touchdown than Josh Allen has coming into this game. And he's played one less game than Josh Allen. Herbert is averaging 2.44 passing touchdowns per game. Andrew Luck owns the rookie passing yards record with 4,374 passing yards. Herbert currently has 2,699. He needs to average 290 a game going forward in order to pass Andrew Luck. Carson Wentz owns the rookie completions record with 379. Herbert currently has 238. He needs to average 23 a game going forward in order to pass Wentz. And he currently averages 26.4 completions per game currently. He's tied for sixth in the NFL in passing touchdowns, again, despite playing one less game than a majority of the other leaders, especially in the top 10. He's third in passing yards per game with 299.9 passing yards per game. He's got a 68.0 completion percentage. He's had a very good year. He can beat you deep. He can beat you short. He functions within the offense. His athleticism and mobility is better than people give him credit for. He ran sparingly at Oregon, but when he did, especially in the bowl game against Wisconsin, he was able to make plays. He's got better speed and athleticism that he gets credit for, and he makes plays. When we go into the advanced metrics with Justin Herbert, I love advanced metrics. I love DYAR and DVOA, and I want to break those things down again. I broke them down a couple weeks ago in the Seattle matchup, but just to refresh everyone's memory, DYAR is defense adjusted yards above replacement. It is the value of a player's performance compared to a replacement level player, and then adjusted for situation and opponent and translated into yardage. It's basically a representation of total value. That is DYAR. DVOA is defense adjusted value over average. It is the value per play over an average player or unit in the same game situation. It measures a player or a team's efficiency by comparing success on every single play to a league average based on situation and opponent. It's a measure of value per play. So those are two things, DYAR and DVOA. Herbert is eighth in QB DYAR this year. Josh Allen is ninth by comparison and reference. Justin Herbert is seventh in quarterback DVOA. Josh Allen, also ninth. So he's a couple spots ahead of Josh Allen in the advanced metrics. He's right there in the raw stats in terms of passing yards, touchdowns, completion percentage. He's in the mix. He's in the thick of things. Anytime you get a rookie who stands out to such a high degree, and there's been several rookies who have stood out this year, but Justin Herbert really took this Chargers team. He came in, he came through, and he's really lit it up in a lot of areas. And the Chargers have decent pieces on offense. Keenan Allen, who we're going to talk about in a slight minute, he's a very good wide receiver one. Mike Williams has been banged up, but he's good. Guyton is a good complementary weapon piece. Hunter Henry is a very good receiving tight end, especially when healthy. They've got a decent enough running game, but Herbert is the straw that stirs that drink. I am excited to see what he looks like against the Bills defense. At the end of the day, he's still a rookie, so I'd like to see him get messed up a little bit by the Bills defense, and it's still a West Coast team that has to come east. I'm not a massive proponent of the narrative that, you know, West Coast teams coming east struggle, but I do think it is something that should be recognized. I don't think it's nothing. I don't think it's something that should be swept under the rug. The Chargers still have to come east. It's a long travel. It's even harder during COVID times. Rookie quarterback, but he's a rookie QB who has played good. Part of the reason he's played good has been his unflinching ability to just feed wide receiver Keenan Allen the ball every way, shape, and form. Keenan Allen currently, right now, wide receiver for the Los Angeles Chargers. He leads the league in receptions with 81. Second in the NFL in receptions is Stephon Diggs, who has 73. So Keenan Allen leads the league with 8 more receptions than Stephon Diggs. He's also first in the league in targets with 112, which is 11 more than Stephon Diggs, who once again is in second. Keenan Allen is ninth in receiving yards with 835. He's got 6 touchdowns. He's one of the best route runners in the NFL, and he's been someone that Herbert's leaned on in his time, in his brief stint as starting quarterback for the Los Angeles Chargers, and I don't think that's bad. I think it's smart. You got to find something that you can anchor to. You need to find a point that you can stick with when you're a rookie in the NFL, especially when you're a rookie quarterback in the NFL, because despite the fact that the game is skewed towards giving an advantage to the offense in today's day and age in the NFL, it's still hard to play quarterback. But Keenan Allen has been a really solid supporting piece for Herbert, and Herbert's taking advantage of it. They feed Keenan Allen again with the targets. He leads the league in targets with 112. Diggs is in second, and he's got 11 less than Keenan Allen. When in doubt, they feed Keenan Allen. When in doubt, Herbert looks to Keenan Allen, but they've still got other supporting pieces. That being said, I think the Bills defense matches up pretty well with the Charger offense in this game. I think depending on what we want to do, depending on how the formations line up, Keenan Allen will go into the slot from time to time. I like the matchup of Trey on Keenan Allen. Keenan Allen is a very good route runner. He's got tremendous technique. He's got good speed and athleticism and agility. He's got tremendous hands. But he's not the type of receiver that traditionally gives Trey problems, which are guys that can just straight fly, guys who are very big, tremendously physical. Allen's good, but he's really successful because of his technique, which is also what Tre'Davious White hangs his hat on when it comes to his success. Trey has great footwork, great hand technique, great play recognition. He's strong in his back pedal and his versatility and hip fluidity. Trey is not this overly athletic marvel. He's not the corner who ran, you know, a 4.3 40 and is 6'1" and extremely athletic and also can return punts and is just juking guys out of their shoes. He's got solid technique. He's a very sound technical player, as is Keenan Allen at the wide receiver position. I like that matchup if Trey gets put on Keenan Allen. As a whole, the Chargers offense is 10th in DVOA as an offensive unit. The Bills defense is currently 17th in defensive DVOA, which may not seem great. Again, 17 towards the lower end of the middle of the pack. But going into the Seahawks game, I mentioned this on last week's pod, going into the Seahawks game, the Bills defensive DVOA was 23rd in the NFL. After playing two of the top offenses in the NFL, in the Seahawks and the Cardinals, the Bills defense rose their DVOA 6 spots. I think that's tremendous. You're playing two of the best offenses in the NFL. You're still banged up. One of those games was the Arizona game where We didn't have Norman and we didn't have Levi because of some COVID things. We haven't had a healthy Matt Milano at all for those games. And he is tremendously important to that Bills defense. The Bills D is course corrected a little bit in the past several weeks. And now they come into a game where they play a young quarterback. They play an explosive offense. They play an offense that has a tremendous number one wide receiver. They play an offense that has good weaponry and supporting pieces around a young quarterback. I want to see what the Bills defense continues to do. And I think they have a good opportunity to succeed in this game. The Chargers offense is strong. I don't think you can deny that with what they've done in Herbert's time. But I think it's a good matchup for the Bills D. And at the very least, it is another good test to see what the Bills defense can do. A comment that was mentioned earlier in the episode here is, you know, being excited to see what the Bills look like coming out of the bye. I think this is something that we're all focused on, and especially the defense, the team as a whole, but especially the defense. And as we go further after this Chargers game and the Bills play the Niners and the Steelers and the Pats and the Broncos and the Dolphins, I know that's not the exact order, but that's who we play. I think there's a lot of focus in the Steeler game and the Pats game and the Miami game, depending on how the Bills look like before that. But each one of these games is another opportunity for the Bills to prove themselves against a differing opponent that they faced in previous weeks. And the defense, something that we're really trying to figure out and really trying to see what they can be and who they're going to be as this year finishes and what they've been trending to be. This is another good test. Explosive offense, a fast offense, talented. They scheme well. They get guys open. And they're led by a rookie QB who set the world on fire. Herbert has, at first, he was just like a cool fantasy quarterback who was putting up yards and some touchies. But he's turned into a pretty solid quarterback. And to see what the Bills look like against a good young quarterback, but still a rookie quarterback who is surrounded by some pieces, but he's surrounded by pieces that the Bills should be able to defend and should be able to guard. I'm excited to see that as we continue on this theme of course correction for the Buffalo Bills defense, which is something, again, that is important, as you see my notebook there, and you hear it as well. Again, I'm a notebook guy. I say it every episode. I don't put my things into my phone or type them. I'm an old school guy. I like to just write it all out. On the other side of the ball, as we switch the graphic there on the bottom, the Chargers defense. I'm loving all the comments coming in. I shall get to them shortly. I appreciate everyone. Keep throwing questions, thoughts, comments, concerns, philosophies, ideologies, maxims, theorems, other things like that into the chat. I love that aspect of doing the live stream. On the other side of the ball, we have the Chargers defense. Fun fact, they are last in the NFL in blitz percentage. They only blitz 15.7% of the time. The majority of their pass rush lies off of their two very good edge rushers, Joey Bosa and Melvin Ingram. The issue for the Chargers defense this year has been both of those guys have been banged up. That is the successful pieces and parts of the Chargers defense. When they're going good, Ingram and Bosa are a terror. Bosa has been banged up all year. He just came back last week after missing time with a concussion. He's also had ankle injuries, knee injuries, and a triceps injury this year. Melvin Ingram missed practice multiple days this week, and as of today, was ruled out. Also ruled out was their second leading sack man in Wosu. Oh, so close. Second leading sack man, he's out. Their number one corner, Casey Hayward, he's also out. They, in Wosu and Ingram and Bosa, they're a good rotation of a three-man edge rushing unit. Two of them are out. Bosa's banged up. We should be able to isolate Joey Bosa. I started the Chargers defense in fantasy football last week because they played the Jets. I expected more sacks. I expected more chaos. They did have a pick six, mainly because of a horrible read by Joe Flacco. But Bosa was not the terror off of the edge that I've been accustomed to seeing when seeing the Chargers or seeing the stat line. Bosa is still good. He's still got talent, but he is severely nicked up. He's banged up. And the week that he had last week was still with having Ingram on the opposite side and doing different things with Ingram out, with Nwosu out. Bosa's their only guy up front that the Bills really have to worry about. And then with their number one cover guy, Casey Hayward, who got beat several times last week against the Jets, with him being out, and with Desmond King, I know some Bills fans know who Desmond King is because they wanted the Bills to trade for him come trade deadline time, but The Bills did not. King went to Tennessee. So without Hayward, without Desmond King, Chris Harris comes back off of the IR this week, though, so that gives the Chargers a bit of a boost. But they're without a lot of their playmakers, a lot of their studs on a defense that was already giving up points. They were a defense that has been leaky all year. They were leaky against the Jets. Again, they got beat deep consistently by Joe Flacco and Breshad Perriman. If Bosa and Ingram, again, Ingram is out. If those two aren't at their best, this defense loses a lot of its bite. And with Bosa banged up and Ingram out, I see this being a pretty successful day, knock on wood, for the Bills offense. The Chargers defense as a whole in this year, they're 20th in DVOA, and the Bills offense is 12th in DVOA coming in to this week. I don't see them having somebody who can guard Stephon Diggs. I think they'll also struggle in the running game if the Bills want to commit to that and go forward with that. I see this as a game where the Bills should, again, knock on wood, comfortably put up anywhere from 30 to 35 points. They potentially could hit the 40s depending on how they choose to move the ball and if they can hit some big plays and how the Chargers D is going to try and defend, knowing that they've got a lot of their studs and playmakers out. If we get into a shootout in this game, which is possible because, again, the Bills' defense hasn't been tremendous and the Chargers' offense has explosive capability, the Bills can match that. The Bills' offense is very good. They've been solid all year, and the Chargers' defense isn't the type that's going to be locking anyone down. They couldn't do it against the Jets. I don't think they're going to do it against the Bills. The Bills have a pretty solid opportunity to put up good point totals coming into this week against the Chargers. Another aspect that I want to talk about here in this Know Thy Enemy episode, Los Angeles Chargers versus the Buffalo Bills, flip that, Buffalo Bills versus Los Angeles Chargers, is special teams. Special teams are an overlooked aspect of football. Special teams is one third of every game. It's a unit that shouldn't go overlooked. And the Bills special teams unit is good. I know special teams usually only get looked at or talked about when it comes to getting a score or a mistake, like allowing a return touchdown or missing a field goal or making a massive field goal if you're Tyler Bass or getting a return touchdown or big plays for Andre Roberts. But the Los Angeles Chargers are bad in their special teams. They are last in special teams DVOA. The Bills are 10th. And the Bills, mainly due to the successful play of Andre Roberts, who has been awesome this year, the Bills are third in the NFL in yards per punt return with 11.9 average yards per punt return. And they're also sixth in yards per kick return with 26.5 average yards per kick return. The Chargers give up the third most yards per punt return with 12.7, and they give up the fourth most yards per kick return with 27.9. This is another advantage the Bills have going into this game. Roberts has been extremely solid in the special teams area for the Bills this year in kick returns and in punt returns, and the Chargers have not been good at covering either. They give up yards. They are leaky in their coverage teams. Again, both in kick and punt return, they give up the third most yards in the punt return game on average. They give up the fourth most yards in the kick return game on average. Again, giving up an average of basically 28 yards per kick return and 13 yards per punt return, that flips the field big time. And Roberts is good at finding lanes, at finding gaps. He has been tremendous for the Bills this year. This is another area where the Bills have an advantage. I expect to see the Bills, provided they can force the Chargers into some punts, I think this is another area where the Bills can maintain an edge, flip the field. I expect to see good starting field position for the Bills coming into this game and also coming out of it. I would see most of their drives starting around their own 30, 35, depending on, again, what the defense does and how they force stops on the Charger offense. But the Bills should be able to have good starting field position on a majority of their drives, making life easy for Josh Allen to get things going. And then again, with what we've discussed for the Charger defense being leaky as a whole on this year, but also being banged up and missing several key contributors for this game, this should be a game, good field position for the Bills offense. They should comfortably be able to put up at least 30 points, which they may need to, because again, the Chargers can score. I would expect the Chargers to put up at least 20. They're a good offense, but I think we can turn over Herbert. I think we can limit some of the effectiveness of Keenan Allen, get after things a little bit, and it's going to be interesting to see what the Bills can do against the Chargers. Just to hit a few points on special teams here. The Bills are a good special teams coverage unit. They are fifth in yards allowed per kick return. Again, fifth from like the lowest. So very good. They're 21st in yards per punt return given up, but they haven't given up a lot of punt returns. So they've got some outliers there. They've given up some big returns and they've only had 11 punt returns against them, which is 23rd in the NFL. So the Bills don't give up a lot of punt returns. They either booted out of bounds or there's fair catches. So there hasn't been a lot of return opportunities in the punting game against the Bills, but they've been good in their kick return coverage. And it's another area where the Bills can excel. I'm seeing the comments lighting up, I'm seeing them light up. And we're going to start going through some of those comments. We're going to start with this first one from Army of One. No John Brown for this week. Who steps up this Sunday? I'm worried about this for the Bills. The games, granted, it may be coincidental, but the games where John Brown has not been present, the Bills' offense has not been as efficient as they have been when he's in there, or as potentially deadly or potent as they are when he's in there. I think the obvious answer is Gabriel Davis. We're at this point of the year where I think he's more comfortable in the offense. He's also a good player. Gabriel Davis. I know he wants to go by Gabriel, so that's what we're going to call him on this show. Gabriel Davis has been a really good player for the Bills this year. He's made some really important catches, some really strong catches, ones that it'd be easy for a rookie or anybody to drop. He's big bodied. He runs good routes. He's fast. He's got to be the one to step up. You need him to stretch the defense and kind of perform a little bit in that John Brown role. I would also expect to see potentially some more Isaiah McKenzie, get some more gadget work in, and do kind of like a replacement by committee aspect for John Brown. John Brown, I know the nickname. I know the 40 time. I know the threat of him always being a vertical threat and what he can do deep, and that's all very true. But John Brown's game as a whole really came together last year when he was the wide receiver one for the Bills. His route running improved, his sensory awareness and timing improved on the offense. He does a lot for the Bills, and his loss is one that I'm not pleased with at all. I mean, I don't want to lose anybody if I'm the Bills, but I think his loss and his impact will be felt, and I don't think you can holistically replace him with just one person. I expect the bulk of the stepping up to be done by Gabe Davis, but I expect to see a little more, bit more McKenzie. And then I don't want to jinx it, but I think Stephon Diggs has a big game this week. I think he's the obvious step up. Just feed it to Stephon Diggs the way Herbert loves to feed it to Keenan Allen. Josh Allen loves to feed it to Stephon Diggs, and also take advantage of the Chargers' weaknesses in coverage and timing and pass rush and their vulnerability that they've had over the middle in giving up passes in the short and intermediate. Let Cole Beasley work a little bit. I think you see a large target share and reception performance from Stephon Diggs. And I think you see Gabe Davis take a majority of the snaps that John Brown would have had. Continuing to go through more comments. Don Burt, I'm not sleeping on the Chargers. Eckler could be back. Harris is probably back. Herbert has looked good. That's all very true. I don't think, I've said it many times on this pod, growing up as a Bills fan, I am secure in nothing. I will be paranoid until the day that I die. I take nothing for granted. I take nothing as, oh yeah, we got this. This is easy. This is going to be a walk in the park. Do not sleep on the Chargers. I know their record, spoke about in the beginning, them being 3-7. They don't have a ton of quality wins or really any quality wins. And they've had losses that have been brutal. But within those losses and within those wins, every single game has been close. They're in every single game that they play, for better or for worse. Do not sleep on the Chargers. That's a good comment. Comment here from Rico. It is Gabe Davis time. That's exactly what it is. And that's how we hit. I've seen a lot of comments. One from Lone Wolf. How will the Bills compensate for the loss of Brown? I'm not sold on Gabe Davis as a reliable alternative. Still mostly an unproven rookie. I'm not completely sold on Gabriel Davis to the point of I think he's ready to occupy the number three wide receiver spot, or he's ready for number two time, or, you know, John Brown is now expendable. But I think what he has shown in the snaps that he's taken, I've liked what I've seen. He's shown good awareness. He's had a couple catches, some toe taps and some toe drags that show his awareness of the boundary and able to adjust his body and make athletic catches to come down with the ball, but also come down in bounds. He's beaten some good coverages. If I could have John Brown, I would much rather have John Brown, but I don't feel as though there is a massive hole without him in there, knowing that we have Gabe Davis and, again, McKenzie. I expect that, and answer some of the other earlier questions, I expect that to see a replacement by committee a bit and not just solely on Gabe Davis. Another comment here from Don Burr. Bills have to come out hot and angry after sitting on that Cardinal loss for 2 weeks. I think this is one that we all want to see as watchers of the Bills, fans of the Bills, people who love the Bills. We want to see that loss against the Cardinals mean something. I think that was the easiest thing coming out of it and being like, well, you know, we saw what Josh Allen said. We saw what Stephon Diggs said in terms of the, you know, use it as fire, use it to motivate you. We heard the same similar type of comments after the playoff loss to the Texans last year. You want that loss to mean something. You want the Bills to use it, because if they don't use it, then it's just an ugly, horrible loss that made the Bills 7-3 instead of 8-2 and has become memeable everywhere, and everybody wants to show it as this amazing play. It's probably going to win like play of the year. It's unfortunate, and you want the Bills to be motivated by that. You want them to be angry and pissed off because of what happened at the end of that game, and I hope they come out, and I hope they do that. Gabe Davis is getting a lot of action in the comments here. Hopefully Gabe Davis, Gabriel, steps it up, because we are going to need it to keep up with the Chargers' big play ability. That is the comment here from Garrick Utley. You touched on it a bit there, Garrick. The Chargers do have, like I said earlier, explosive ability, big play ability. They have home run potential. They can beat you surgically and kind of, you know, matriculate the ball down the field, to use the John Madden term, or they can hit big plays. So it's important for the Bills offense to work the Chargers defense. And whether we do it via the run or especially with the pass, as we have against the majority of teams this year, I don't see, again, knock on wood, I don't see it being a tremendous issue of the Bills moving the ball against the Charger defense. Another comment from Army of One. Beasley this Sunday. Josh Allen needs to use him. Yeah, Cole Beasley's been a tremendously unsung hero this year for the Bills. If you follow a lot of fantasy forums, you get so much talk about how Beasley has put up wide receiver 2 fantasy numbers this year. He's had big games. He's reliable. And that's just from a fantasy perspective. From an actual on-field X's and O's perspective, Cole Beasley's been tremendously reliable. If only we had won that Cardinals game. I know the catch to Stephon Diggs was the one that put the Bills up, and it was a great throw by Allen and a great route and catch by Diggs. But the play earlier in the drive, that one-handed catch by Beasley on the out, Allen almost airmailed that throw. That was a bad throw by Josh Allen. Beasley straight one-handed it, put that mid out there and brought it in tremendously and got his feet down, and it converted a third down. Beasley has been so good for the Bills this year, and he doesn't get talked about. He was often the forgotten man on the Cowboys offense, and I think the same with the Bills. Josh Allen is the focal point. Stephon Diggs is the focal point. But Cole Beasley's had a very strong year, and I would expect to see him continue to be successful against the Chargers. Dave L. Herbert hasn't seen anyone like Hyde and Poyer and our disguise coverages. I really hope you said disguise coverage as a pun, because in the name of this show, you could have said anything and it could have been completely wrong. But if you would have somehow woven in disguise coverage into that or some form of that phrasing, I would have pulled this comment up. So tremendous. I would agree with that. Hyde and Poyer are a unique safety tandem. I think they're one of the best safety tandems in the NFL. Poyer's having a tremendous year. Their versatility and interchangeability in terms of being able to both play strong and free, although I think Poyer is much better around the line of scrimmage and better suited to be in the box versus Micah Hyde. But they're a tremendous safety duo and a tremendous safety tandem. But Herbert has faced, I know he may not have faced a safety tandem like that, but Herbert has faced quality defensive units, and he has put up numbers. Some of that has been garbage time, but he has put up good numbers. He has generated scoring drives against good defenses. Don't completely discount Herbert. I know he hasn't seen everything yet, and the Bills defense is tremendous at disguising coverage. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. They're very good, and Poyer and Hyde are tremendously key to the Bills' defense's ability to disguise coverages. Eric Turner from Cover One has done several tremendous pieces on the old Twitter and on YouTube about the Bills' defense's ability to disguise coverage and how key Hyde and Poyer are in that. It's tremendous. So I think the Bills' ability to, I'm going to say it again, to disguise coverage and give Herbert some looks pre-snap and then change and do things post-snap could confuse him a little bit, could lead to some turnovers and some incompletions and some errant throws. Hyde and Poyer are tremendously key, but don't use that to completely discount what Herbert has done this year. PJ, Teague is the last name, I'm going to guess. Apologies if that's wrong. I'm a little concerned if Taron Johnson is covering him. I'm assuming this is in reference to Keenan Allen because I saw this comment come up when it came to Keenan Allen. Yes, I am as well. Keenan in the slot is a handful for anyone, let alone someone who has struggled in coverage this year, i.e. Taron Johnson. He did play a little better against Arizona. He forced that fumble. He did miss a tackle on the first series of the game, but he got a little better. I would also be worried with that. But if Keenan Allen slides inside, I would expect Taron to receive some sort of help when it comes to that. I don't think the Bills are going to leave him on an island one-on-one. And again, especially with how this offense functions and with everything, not everything, but a decent amount of the offense funnels to Keenan Allen. If he slides inside and the matchup is with Taron, I would expect there to be some sort of help and or scheme ability to not allow him to get that kind of one-on-one interaction. Keep going through the comments. Oh, another one from PJ. Again, relates to this. I would prefer Dane Jackson to move to inside. That's something that myself and Greg Thompson discussed on the Cover One podcast last Sunday. It's something that myself and Greg, again, and Anthony and Eric from the Hoof podcast discussed on last week's episode of the Hoof, the midweek episode last week. Dane Jackson's been really good. I think he's someone that a lot of people are excited to see. He was physical against DeAndre Hopkins. He was physical against DK Metcalf. I like what he's brought. I'm not tremendously confident and ready to roll him out as the number two, and I don't think the Bills are either. I think Norman and Levi still platoon that number two corner spot, but I would, to your original comment, I would like to see Dane Jackson get a little bit of work inside as a potential replacement for Taron Johnson. I like Taron's physicality, but even just off of his past injury history and what he's had, he's somebody that hasn't stayed on the field with regularity, combined with the poor execution and lack of technique he's played with this year and how he's gotten beat in zone and in man and the yards that he gives up per target, which is close to last in the league and has been for a decent amount of the year. I would like to see Dane Jackson get some work inside. His physicality is a tremendous asset, and I want to see him continue to get more work. That is a very, very, very strong comment. We're getting a lot of comments here on Dane Jackson. A lot of comments here. Another one from Lone Wolf. Diggs, Beasley, Davis, Croft, Knox, and McKenzie, and maybe the running backs thrown in for a few catches. Is that lineup enough to outscore the Chargers offense if need be? Yes, I think it is. The Bills offense can put up points. Oh, hear that horn there. Those are the sounds of New York City for you guys. I think the Bills offense is built to score. Dable is in very good command in terms of the play calling and scheme ability of this offense. I'm a fan of what he's done this year. Josh Allen, the further he's come from that shoulder injury, has looked better, has looked sharper. We've got one of the best receivers in the NFL in Stephon Diggs. We've got a good supporting cast. And I actually really like Tyler Croft. I know we always talk about Dawson Knox for better or for worse. Tyler Croft has been a solid receiving tight end, and he's been a solid blocking tight end as well. He's been somebody who I feel comfortable in having be the guy out there at tight end in the passing game and in the blocking game. So I'm okay with that lineup of weaponry to support Josh Allen. I think it is good enough to get it done. As I mentioned earlier, I think this Bills offense, again, despite John Brown being out, this Bills offense should put up at least 30 against this Chargers defense. And that should be good enough to get it done. I think we even pushed 35 to 40, so that'll be nice. Some weather comments coming out. PJ answering some questions. It is supposed to be 52 and sunny on Sunday. That's fantastic. As we keep scrolling through the comments, I see a lot of conversation, I love this. This is fantastic. From Lone Wolf, does Touchdown Jesus get some offensive snaps? Vern Comoro from the Packers. I don't think so. Maybe potentially one or two. Maybe they got something in there for him. But I think the heavy amount of offensive snaps are going to go to Diggs and Beasley and Davis and McKenzie. And also, as pointed out earlier by you, the running back aspect, Moss, Singletary in the passing game and in the running game. I think you'll see that divvied up a decent amount. I don't think Touchdown Jesus is going to get a ton of snaps there. Ooh, was hoping to get a comment on this, and here we go. This is what I kind of want to end this episode on. Apologies for those of you who had further comments that I wasn't able to get to. The chat blew up tonight in this episode, and I love the interaction. Thank you so much to anyone and everyone for commenting and throwing everything in there. This has been tremendously enjoyable for me. I almost shouldn't have prepped anything and done anything on this episode. We could have just stayed through your guys' comments for this entire time and got a solid 45 to 50 out of it. So thank you tremendously for that. But Ryan McClain, who gets the start at the other guard position, Winters or Bodker? Cody Ford is out for the year, as announced today. I know some people in the Twitter sphere and on the internet have been making statements that Cody Ford has been a bust and that he's been a letdown. I don't think the sample size is large enough to declare that or make that level of concrete statement at this point in his career, but I think it is a loss. And I know he still has to clean up his passing footwork and get better in pass block, but his run block is strong. His pass pro needs to get better, but his run blocking is strong. I think that is going to be a loss as we go forward. That being said, to answer this question, I hope it's Ike Bodker. I'd like to put him at left guard. So you got Dawkins, Bodker, Mitch Morse, who is returning to the starting lineup this week, Feliciano at right guard, and then Darrell Williams at right tackle. If they start Winters, that means Winters at right guard. Feliciano is at left. I haven't been a huge fan of Winters this year. Bodker, I think, is a bit, it's like six of one, half a dozen of the other, but I feel more comfortable and confident with Bodker being in that lineup. And Bodker's actually, he's got some good ratings this year. I believe he's the 16th best rated guard or offensive lineman this year per PFF. One of those two, I forget the stat. I got a lot of numbers in my head, but he's 14 points better. I know that for a fact. He's 14 points better in terms of his grade than Brian Winters has been. No disrespect to Winters, but he's got beaten several times, several games quite badly. He hasn't looked strong at that spot. He hasn't been an anchor point that we need him to be. I would be more comfortable with Bodker. I think you could see either or at this point. They've used Winters more and put him ahead of Bodker. So I think 55-45 in terms of percentage chance that Winters gets the start over Bodker. I would prefer to have Bodker, though. No disrespect to Winters, which I guess I am saying disrespect to him. Comment from Tristan there. I think it's Bodker. I hope so. I hope so. And another comment from Tristan. I think the running game gets a huge boost is what I think you're going for there with Morse and Feliciano together again. I think so too. The running game is something that I've had my eye on, but we haven't seen in a perfect world. We haven't seen what Feliciano, Morse, and Cody Ford are going to look like together. We won't see that now after the season ending injury to Cody Ford, but I want to see Morse and Feliciano together. I want to see what we can do. Comment here from Marcel Rios. Winters is a penalty machine. Yeah, he gets penalties. He gets beat with power rushes and speed rushes. It's something that I'm not tremendously comfortable with him. Another comment there from Marcel Bates. Oh, why not Bates? Yeah, I like Bodker more than Bates, especially at guard. I just feel more comfortable with his size and body type and the results that he's produced so far. I also think in terms of just straight prediction, what the coaching staff is going to go with, I think they would lean with either Bodker or Winters before looking at Bates. I almost prefer Bates to Winters as well. I feel bad ragging on Brian Winters like that, but yeah, I don't feel confident or comfortable with him. But the coaching staff does. They've chosen him several times. I know a lot of that has been due to injury and kind of having their hand forced a little bit, but that's something to definitely keep an eye on this week in terms of what that offensive line looks like and how they come together and what they're able to do and what the running game looks like, what everything looks like for the Bills offense in this game, in a big game and an important game coming out of the bye against the Los Angeles Chargers. As the graphic shows there on the bottom, it says toodles, you guys. That means the show is about to come to a close. As I stated earlier, I want to thank everybody for riding with me on this episode, whether you're here on the live stream, throwing in comments, throwing in some engagement, or you're just watching the live stream in general, or you're catching this later on YouTube, or you're listening to the audio only that's uploaded on YouTube, where you're listening on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Facebook, anything like that. I appreciate any and every listen that I get from everybody in this Bills Mafia universe. Thank you so much for riding with me on this episode. Hope you guys all had a great Thanksgiving. For those of you who joined me live, I appreciate you guys coming out of your food comas on this Black Friday. Hope you guys got some good deals, bought some good stuff, contributed to the retail economy, and spent some money and bought some cool things for you or your family and friends and loved ones. I hope you and your family and friends and loved ones are all staying safe, especially through these holiday times with everything going on in this world. Stay safe. Thank you for riding with me on this episode. Please rate and review and subscribe to Disguise Coverage. Give me a follow on the Twitter. Again, the handle is at pro_ant. That's pro2_ant. Find Disguise Coverage on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, Facebook, on the Twitter, anywhere and everywhere. You can also find podcasts, any type of platforms and things like that. Thank you very much for your support. I cherish it greatly and appreciate it greatly. Go Bills, and I will see you guys next week.